Thank you very much for the kind invitation and allowing me to address this audience. I'm glad to be here. And before I actually get started, let me introduce a little bit more about myself. So I got my degree in Germany, and when it was time to go to college for me, it was really biophysics that I was interested in. I had excellent teachers in high school in both physics and in biology, and it was just about the time when the genetic revolution really came online. People started to mutate genes and express proteins that couldn't be expressed before because you didn't have the techniques to mutate genes, and now this was coming online, and so this was an exciting field to be in. But ironically, I hated chemistry. I had a poor teacher in chemistry in high school, and so I wanted to avoid chemistry at all costs. And then I realized, well, you can't really avoid chemistry if you're interested in biophysics, right? So it's the link, it links the two. You cannot understand biology without having a basic understanding of chemistry, and physics, of course, is the foundation of chemistry. So really, I had to do chemistry. And I think it was in my second year in college, I sat in organic chemistry lecture, and the light bulbs came on. It started to make sense. I looked at these orbital models, and all of a sudden, I fell in love with chemistry, and so today, I'm a chemistry teacher, of all things. Now, I would love to be a student again, like you are, because this is a time of scientific revolutions. There's not a week that goes by that you read in a paper stuff that would have been science fiction 30 years ago. And so I encourage you students to be broad in your approach. Study chemistry, study physics, study biology. And then when it comes time to choose a career or go to graduate school or maybe even go to medical school, you have a broad basis, and then you can choose and pick what interests you most. So with this said, let me introduce you to something I'm doing in my research, and I'm looking at an enzyme called oxalate decarboxylase. This is an enzyme that breaks down the most common toxin that we find in nature. It's prevalent in our diet, oxalate or oxalic acid. Plants produce it, we eat plants, we consume oxalic acid. And I'll talk a little bit more about this in my introduction, but I'm more interested not so much in the applications of the enzyme, but in how does it do its job? How does it work? How does it convert oxalate into harmless CO2 and formate? So that's the theme, and I'm going to use EPR, electron paramagnetic resonance, also known as electron spin resonance or electron magnetic resonance. You probably have heard about nuclear magnetic resonance. Really, nuclear magnetic resonance is very pervasive. It's used in medicine, it's used in science, it's used in spectroscopy, in imaging. There are so many different applications of nuclear magnetic resonance. And electron paramagnetic resonance is sort of like its little brother. It doesn't look directly at nuclear, it looks at electron spins. But it's pretty much the same theory and the same technique with some changes in the technology. Instead of looking at radio frequencies as the main carrier frequency for our technique, we need to use radar frequencies, microwaves. And then, so I'll introduce you to high-field EPR. High-field EPR is actually what drew me to Florida because of the National High Magnetic Field Laboratory in Tallahassee. This is a national lab that was, in fact, it's the only national lab that we have in Florida that was built in the early 90s and was situated in Tallahassee, but it's run jointly by FSU and UF and Los Alamos National Lab. And they were looking for faculty members to do research there. And so I wanted to do research in high magnetic fields. This was exciting, new technology, you could learn new stuff. And so that's why I applied, and this is why I became a professor at UF. So we're gonna talk a little bit about that. And then I'm gonna introduce you to some additional experiments that are multiple resonance. ENDOR stands for electron nuclear double resonance. So what we do there, we take a sneak peek at just the nuclei surrounding an electron spin. We're gonna do NMR on just those nuclei, ignoring everything else, and that sort of shines a flashlight on the active site of the enzyme. We can then determine how does a substrate molecule bind to the manganese that is in that enzyme that actually is critical for catalysis. And then I'll talk a little bit about spin trapping. Spin trapping is a technique that allows you to study free radicals that are elusive because they are short-lived, right? You don't have that much time to study them because they live only for microseconds or milliseconds. And what we do, we add a spin trap. The spin trap reacts with that radical, stabilizes it. It's another radical, obviously, but it has traces of the original radical. And then you have 20, 30 minutes of time to do the EPR so you can prepare your sample, have a cup of coffee, and come back and still do your experiment. And finally, I'll finish with a summary and outlook. So let me get started. First, acknowledge my coworkers. I have a number of very talented graduate students and undergraduate students on this project. Omar Tahir is my senior graduate student right now. Justin Goodsell is a first year graduate student who is just now starting to do experiments. Richard Imaram is a previous graduate student who is now back in his home country in Thailand, a lecturer at a university there. And Fabrizio is a master's student who has since left and went back to Italy. And the rest really are undergraduate students. So we do research and we use the help of undergraduate students. So if you at some point decide to come to the University of Florida, you can be involved in research even as an undergraduate student. I'm not the only one who works with undergraduate students. We have large groups that utilize the help of undergraduate students. And what better way of learning chemistry or learning physics than go in a lab and actually participate in cutting edge research? I have some senior collaborators. Nigel Richards, he is a biochemist. I used to get my samples from him. Now he's moved away to Indianapolis. Now I have to make my samples myself. David Silverman, he's since retired, but he had his hand in some of the areas that I'll be talking about. And then, of course, the group in Tallahassee at the National High Magnetic Field Laboratory under the leadership of Stephen Hill. And the indoor experiments were done with people at the University of California in Davis. They have a tube-end indoor instrument that we were using, and funding comes from National Science Foundation, National Institutes of Health, and the National High Magnetic Field Laboratories, UCGP, or in-house users program. So this is something you don't want to get, kidney stones. It's estimated that about a third of Americans either had a kidney stone in their life or will have a kidney stone in their life or just now have a kidney stone in their life. So one, two, three, you guys can get together afterwards and figure out who's going to be the lucky or unlucky one. Kidney stones consist mainly of calcium oxalate. And they happen if you overload yourself with oxalic acid or oxalate. And we do this when we eat, well, these foods are rich in oxalate. Spinach, for example, many people don't know spinach actually contains quite a bit of oxalate. So if your mom told you you need to eat your spinach, she obviously didn't know about the oxalate. So people who have had kidney stones need to take it easy on these foods because the oxalic acid, we have no ability to get rid of the oxalic acid except flushing it out with our kidneys. And if you have too much, then the kidneys can't flush it out. It then precipitates, and you have kidney stones. There are three different types of oxalate-degrading enzymes that are known. They are named by different names because of the different chemistry they do. Oxalate oxidase is mainly present in higher plants. In fact, the enzyme germin, which is used for germinating seeds, is oxalate oxidase. Oxalate decarboxylase is present in fungi and bacteria. That is the enzyme that I'm studying. And then oxalate-CoA decarboxylase is also present in bacteria. And that's the enzyme that some of us, hopefully many of us, have in their gut. It's a gut bacterium, and it actually breaks down oxalate. So it's a helper bacterium. It occupies the smaller intestines, and it's completely anaerobic, and it actually lives on oxalate. And people who have that gut bacterium typically don't get kidney stones, because they don't absorb the oxalate because it's food for those bacteria. They break it down and then it becomes harmless gas. Potential applications for these enzymes. Obviously, there's a therapeutic use. You want to get rid of kidney stones. In fact, there is a medical team at UF that tries to put the enzyme on the tip of a little catheter that you can then insert into the kidney and then dissolve the kidney stone. I'm not sure how far they have gotten with that project. It doesn't sound like it's a lot of fun to me. Diagnostic use, yes, you can test for the oxalate in urine. In fact, this is currently being used. Oxalate oxidase primarily is used for diagnostic use. There's also nutritional use. You could use oxalate oxidase or decarboxylase to reduce your oxalate intake either through probiotics or by simply eating the enzyme. The food industry has an interest. They want to get rid of the oxalate from beverages or from other foodstuffs. There's also industrial use. Think about all the tubing that the pulp and paper industry is using to process their process flows. It comes from plants, has lots of oxalate. Oxalate precipitates easily, especially with calcium around, and so they have a huge crusting problem in their tubes. Every so often they have to clean out their tubes. That's costly. So if you could actually add something to that process flow that eats up the oxalate while you're working on your process flow, then that would be a big help to them. And there are also agricultural uses. Yes?
Somebody was mentioning that the probiotics, they were not sure how much of that stuff really gets into the gut.
You mean when you try to? Right. Yes, so it's actually, that is actually true, because these bacteria, they're anoxygenic. I mean, they don't survive under oxygen. So nobody really knows how you get them. But people have actually demonstrated that you can actually implant them into your intestines the other way. So I'm not going to get into details there. Okay, so let's go back to our oxalate decarboxylase. This is the reaction that it catalyzes. We have the monoanion of oxalate, where it's just one proton left, and it breaks down oxalate, the monoanion, into carbon dioxide and into formate. The enzyme occurs in wood decaying fungi as well as in bacteria. Please note the pKa of oxalate is 1.4 and 4.3. So that tells you, if this is the substrate, the enzyme is only active at low pH. In fact, the optimum pH where the enzyme works is about pH 4. There are X-ray crystal structures known for the bacterial enzyme. They're very helpful because they tell you where you find the active site. They tell you where you find the manganese centers that make that enzyme work. And they can also help you to identify targets where you can go in and mutate some amino acids, try to modify the chemistry. So what we see here is the unit cell, or the contents of the unit cell of those protein crystals. And the green spaghetti here, that's a layer of oxalate decarboxylase on top, and the red spaghetti is the layer on the bottom. And you see the blue dots here, the blue dots represent the manganese ions. So we have two blue dots here. They're enclosed in what looks like a little ice cream cone or a barrel. These are beta barrel domains, and two of them belong together to one subunit of the enzyme. So we have one subunit here, another subunit here, and another subunit here. So basically a triangle made out of three subunits, and then at the bottom we have another triangle of three subunits as well. Let's take a closer look at those manganese binding sites, because the manganese is where the action takes place. So we have the N-terminal site. This is one of the crystal structures that has been published. And you find the manganese coordinated to the amino acid side chains with three histidines right here. The number refers to the number in the amino acid chain of the enzyme, a glutamate here. And then we have two free valencies. And in this particular crystal structure, one of those valencies is occupied by a coordinating water, and the other one by a coordinating formate. Formate, of course, is the product. So people immediately jump to the conclusion the N-terminal site has to be the active site, because why would there be product there? Which is, of course, not a foregone conclusion at all, because who knows, maybe the formate ends up in the wrong site, or why would the product even be there if the enzyme tries to get rid of the product? Here's the C-terminal site, very similar in its coordination, again three histidines, a glutamate, and two water molecules. So no product molecule here. Now, there's a second crystal structure. And by a lucky stroke, that second crystal structure actually looks different than the first crystal structure. So let's take a look at that second crystal structure. Let's start with the C-terminal side, the side that people think is not the active side. Again, we have the three histidines and the glutamate, but only one water molecule ligated. So this is a different ligand environment. We have five instead of six ligands. That should change the spectrum of that manganese as far as EPR is concerned. We're going to come back to that later on. The main difference between these two structures, the anion structure and the use structure, is a flexible loop that either opens a pathway right here. This is basically a picture that shows you the van der Waals radii of your amino acid side chains. And what's in green, that's really the surface, the van der Waals surface of that protein. And you see there's a pathway all the way down from the outside world, from the solution, to that N-terminal manganese, where that formate molecule has been bound. And in the second structure, that pathway is closed. So there is a flexible loop that either closes the ice cream cone up or opens it up and lets the and opens a pathway for the substrate to go in. Here's another picture of the same effect. So this is our N-terminal manganese. We have two crystal structures here, overlaid, one in orange, one in gray. They look identical, except for that flexible loop here. This would be the open structure here in blue, and the green one would be the closed structure. So this now led to the conclusion, yes, the N-terminal side is the active side, because why would there be two different conformations? Right? So the enzyme opens up, substrate goes in, then it closes the lid. At that point, it's ready to do the chemistry. Oxalate breaks down, and then you have to let the products out, so it opens back up, lets the product out, and then it's ready for another round. Okay, so very attractive proposition. And we're in the business of trying to understand whether that's really what's happening, and we're trying to understand the chemistry of that catalytic process.
Can we tell how fast that's happening?
So that's actually a good question. How fast is that lid motion happening? Unfortunately, those experiments have not been done yet. Now, one way to use EPR to do those experiments would be you put a little spin label on that flexible lid and look how fast that spin is moving. The techniques that let you do that, the trouble with that is though, the manganese also is paramagnetic, and so it will interact with the spin on the flexible lid. So it's not clear to me that we can actually learn something from that experiment unless we somehow make that manganese silent. Okay, but let's move on and let's look at the proposed catalytic mechanism. This is, when you read the literature, this is how people believe the enzyme turns over. Now they're focused on the N-terminal side. Now, what I didn't tell you before, and I have to tell you now, the enzyme needs oxygen to turn over. Without oxygen, there's no turnover. But it does not use up oxygen. In fact, this is the only enzyme, to my knowledge, that uses oxygen as a co-catalyst. Right? It needs oxygen, but it doesn't use up oxygen. Overall, decarboxylation is a redox neutral process. So you're not oxidizing anything. Well, you start oxidizing, but then you have to reduce. So the electron count in the end has to be neutral. So we're starting off in the oxidized state of the manganese, and people put that oxygen on the N-terminal manganese because, well, it has to be somewhere close, right? There's no experimental evidence that that oxygen is actually bound to the manganese. In fact, I will show you later that that cannot be true. Our experiments show that it has to be someplace else. Oxalate, this is oxalate, the monoanion of oxalate, has to bind. In this picture, since we have only six places where the manganese can bind, it has to bind monodentate. Basically, only one oxygen is ligated to the manganese. This is not how a self-respecting oxalate likes to bind a transition metal. It wants to bind bidentate. It has so many oxygens here, right? It would rather flip this oxygen over on this position and then bind like a claw on the manganese bidentate. Or potentially use this oxygen, flip that over, and bind bidentate head-on, which is another perfectly good way of binding the oxalate to the manganese. But monodentate, every inorganic chemist that looks at that would cringe. So anyways, but this is the proposed catalytic mechanism. And we have now the first step being a proton-coupled electron transfer step. What that means is that an electron moves and a proton moves at the same time, or very shortly after each other. So where does the electron go? Well, the electron comes from the oxalate, has to go to the manganese. It reduces the manganese, so manganese goes from oxidation state 3 to 2. The oxalate loses an electron. That weakens that carbon-carbon bond here between the two halves of the oxalate. And as a result, we're going to lose carbon dioxide in the next step. The proton comes from the monoanion, and it gets picked up by one of those amino acids. Let me flip back to this is the amino acid that's considered to be the transient base that takes up that proton and moves it out of the way so that the oxalate is now present as a dianion and can undergo the catalytic process. This is now a radical, free radical, has an unpaired electron spin. It's very short-lived. I cannot see that with EPR directly. Nor would I ever expect it to be visible because it's coupled strongly to a paramagnetic manganese. So even if I were to able to see it, it would have a very, very broad spectrum. I wouldn't actually be able to make sense of it. But it leaves too short, and then I end up with another intermediate radical. This is a CO2 minus radical anion. This, by the way, I can see, and I will show you evidence of this radical later on in the talk. At this point, we have broken down oxalate into carbon dioxide and into a CO2 minus radical anion, and we need to complete this cycle. So the electron comes back and the proton comes back. Now the proton gets stuck on the carbon. So what you do in the process, you take an acidic proton. This is an acidic proton because it hangs off of an oxygen. You take it out of commission and stick it on a carbon, and therefore the pH goes up. This, by the way, is the process that people believe bacteria and fungi use for this enzyme. They excrete it into the extracellular compartment, and there it finds oxalic acid, and then it works on that oxalic acid, raises the pH, and then the bacteria and the fungi can invade new territory and can multiply. So at this point then, we have the proton stuck on the carbon, we have a formate, and that's our product, and then that formate can leave, and the enzyme is ready for another round. So that's the idea. Now, with EPR, we have the ability to look at unpaired electron spins. And there are quite a few of them here in this picture. Manganese 3, manganese 2, these are, especially if they're high spin, these are paramagnetic species. I can actually look at them. I can detect them with EPR. I can follow them. The problem, of course, is to distinguish the two manganese in the structure. Right? I have a C-terminal, I have an N-terminal manganese. So the first step we have to do is to figure out which is which. Can we distinguish them spectroscopically? And if we can we focus on the N-terminal side? Can we follow the reaction on the N-terminal side? The other radicals that I'm going to be interested in are, of course, these intermediate radicals, the CO2 minus anion, and the superoxide, which, by the way, we can also spin trap. Okay, so this will set up the stage for the rest of the talk. I'm now going to show you spectra that I've taken with my EPR spectrometer, both in Gainesville at lower fields and in Tallahassee at very high fields. And those spectra will tell the story of what those manganese are about, what they're doing, and what those free radicals are doing. So what we try to do, we try to investigate the different manganese sites to figure out the active site. We try to characterize the enzyme substrate complex, look for radical intermediates, and hopefully when we're done with this, we'll develop a consistent mechanism for the catalysis of the enzymes and fix the problems that are present in that mechanism. But before I do, let me briefly give you an introduction into EPR. As Gajendra already mentioned, you have electron spins and you have a magnetic field, and the electron spins are associated with a magnetic moment. So they have like a little magnetic needle attached to themselves. And so if the spin is up, the magnetic moment points down. And if the magnetic field is in the opposite direction, that lifts the energy. So the high energy state would be the spin up. and the low energy state would be the spin down. The high energy state, the magnetic moment points down, north pole is down. In the low energy state, the north pole is up. So I can split my electron spin orientations with a magnetic field. And that's the effect I'm going to use to detect my EPR signal. The way this is done, you irradiate your sample with radio frequencies or microwaves, and you try to set those frequencies to an energy gap that you wish to reach with your magnetic field and your spin system. So we're going to irradiate our spins, our manganese, and our free radicals with microwaves that have that energy gap. So H nu, the energy of those microwave photons, will be able to bridge that gap. And then I'm going to move the magnetic field. I'm going to scan the magnetic field. When I'm in resonance, I'm going to see an absorption of my microwaves. Right? It's sort of like a UV-vis spectrum, except I'm not using visible light. I'm going to use microwave light. I'm going to use a resonator because it's much more difficult to detect microwaves directly than it is optical photons. But basically what this is, it's an absorption spectrum. And I induce that absorption spectrum by sweeping my magnetic field through resonance. Now this is the picture for a single electron spin, such as my free radicals that I'm interested in. If I look at the manganese, especially the manganese 2, it's a little bit more complicated. Manganese 2 is a sextet system, which means it has five unpaired electron spins, five electron spins that are parallel to each other. They add up to a total spin of 5 halves. So I have a lot more states than just 2 to consider. So the next graph introduces that. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different electron spin states that I need to consider. Each of these states is further split by the fact that I have a nuclear spin on the manganese. That's also 5 halves. So each of these states is split into 6 more. Now the splitting for the nuclear spin is much smaller because the nuclear spin has a much smaller magnetic moment. And now I have to look at the transitions between these spin states. Well, turns out that the +1/2 to -1/2 transition, that is usually what you see because those gives you the sharpest lines. So you don't really need a lot of concentration of enzyme to see those lines, right? So here, very sharp lines because these transitions are not affected by the orientation of your enzyme with respect to the external magnetic field. Well, it's not quite true. They're a little bit affected, not much. If you go to high field, yes, you'll see that these lines will broaden. Sometimes they may even split. And that depends on the fine structure. The fine structure is an interaction between those electron spins, between those 5 electron spins on that manganese. And the fine structure depends on the geometry that manganese finds itself in. If you have a very symmetric environment, the fine structure is small. If you have a very asymmetric environment, the fine structure is large. Asymmetric, such as in the case of a pentacoordinated manganese, right? Like that C-terminal site that I showed you before, where you have only 5 ligands, that's an asymmetric environment. You expect a large fine structure there. Whereas the hexacoordinated sites, that N-terminal and that C-terminal site, where you have just 6 ligands around it, it's much more symmetric. You expect a smaller fine structure. So fine structure will affect the line width of these 6 lines. Now I can also look at these transitions here. And especially if I'm interested in, this by the way is the fine structure parameter D. This is going to be an important parameter that I'm trying to measure because that tells me what kind of symmetry my manganese is in. Is it high symmetry, is it low symmetry? Now the fact that this fine structure parameter enters into the energy distance between my states and the fine structure is really dependent on the orientation of your molecule with respect to the magnetic field, make sure that these transitions are smeared out over a really large field range. And in fact, if you can see this transition here between -5/2 and -3/2, these are, by the way, the spin quantum numbers, then you see a spectrum that looks like this. If you see that spectrum, you can directly read off your fine structure parameter from the spectrum. It's usually not the case because usually you have a mixture of things and you have to simulate, which I'll show you later on. If you see the spectrum, you can also distinguish between positive and negative fine structure. The parameter can be positive or negative. The positive one would be the black one, and the negative D would give you the red spectrum, I believe. So the strategy is we're going to cool down to the lowest temperature possible, where Boltzmann statistics tells us that only the MS equals minus 5.5 is populated. We're not expecting any of these transitions at such low temperatures. Now, unfortunately, I cannot go to 1 Kelvin at the magnet lab for reasons of, I guess, funding. I would love to go to 1 Kelvin where I would really only see this transition. I can go to 3 Kelvin, which is pretty good, but these sharp lines will still bleed through. So you're going to see some of those lines in the 3 Kelvin spectrum. You'll just have to ignore them at this point. So at 3 Kelvin, I'm going to see this transition. I can simulate that. I get my D parameters. And then I can go to higher temperatures. That would be 20 Kelvin. I can study these transitions. And I can look at the broadening of these transitions. If they're very broad, then that tells me there are also species there that have higher, larger D parameters. Okay, so are we ready to look at spectra at this point? Let's go. So this is the strategy. I'm going to observe transitions between these higher spin manifolds. This is these transitions at the lowest temperature possible. Then I'm going to go to intermediate temperatures. I'm going to look at the sextet of lines. And finally, I'm going to look at my higher field, at my higher spin transitions at these intermediate temperatures as well. So here's the spectrum. Please look at the magnetic field axis. This is 11.6 Tesla. So that is actually feasible with a superconducting magnet. We're going not to sweep the superconducting coil, but we have an extra field sweep that we can tune. And the yellow line represents the actual spectrum that has been measured, the raw data, at 3 Kelvin. The white line is the sum of three simulated species that are listed here. The red one here is actually doing a pretty good job, almost half of the intensity here. We're going to ignore the sextet here in the center because that is obviously the signal that I'm not interested in at the moment. I see these double peaks here, so that's good as well. But that doesn't explain the whole spectrum. That's site number one, has a negative D of 1270 megahertz and an E parameter, which is the asymmetry parameter of the fine structure of 240 megahertz. It represents about 50% of the EPR visible manganese. So that could be one of our sites. In fact, we believe that is the N-terminal site. That is our active site. I'll show you later why we believe that to be the case. Then we have a second site that gives rise to the shoulder here. So that explains the shoulder. Also has some additional intensity here in the middle. Otherwise, it would be difficult to get a better fit here. I mean, I need that site in order to get a good fit here. Also negative D, somewhat larger in magnitude, somewhat larger E. Finally, I have a third site. That would be my blue line. That gives rise to this little shoulder and the additional intensity that I need on this side. That has a positive D of about 2,000 megahertz and a very small E. Only occupies about 11% of the EPR visible manganese. Now, you would say, well, I don't really believe that that is a signal. I mean, this looks sort of smallish, and how can you be convinced that that is really a signal? Well, this is where I now go to 20 Kelvin. I'm looking at my sextet here at the central part of the spectrum, because if I have such a large D, I should see a splitting in those sextet lines. And that's, in fact, what I see. So now I'm going to just look at the sextet lines here, and I see splitting here. That splitting comes primarily from site number three, so I can use the same parameters I had before to simulate now my sextet. Also, I see a shoulder here on the low field side. That shoulder comes from yet a fourth site, has only one significant digit in the D and E because it's very difficult to simulate. But it's in the range of about 4 gigahertz, and you see this is actually the sextet line. See how that has been pulled and squeezed and mangled, and it doesn't really look like a sextet anymore. Looks like a sextet of multiplets. Well, this is what happens when your D gets too large. It really changes the sextet lines. There are markers, field markers that I have put in here. Those are these two lines, though. They don't belong to my sample. So now, the final spectrum at high field that I'm going to show you is, I'm going to look in the noise here to the left and the right, because I'm trying to see these signals at the higher temperature as well, because they should also correspond to my simulation. And here they are. Again, my sextet is squeezed in the center. And what I see here are sharp lines here. This is not noise. These are actually repeatable lines. I also see what's known as a peak pattern here that I cannot simulate otherwise. And that is now my fifth site. Look at the size of the D, 10.65 gigahertz. That is clearly a very asymmetric manganese. In fact, that is the D parameter that we expect for a pentacoordinated manganese. So that's the signature of our C-terminal manganese on one of the crystal structures. Okay, so now I'm in trouble. I showed you two different manganese in my crystal structure, and now I show you five different manganese sites in the spectrum. So which is which? How can I make sure that I understand that this is the N-terminal site and the rest is really different conformations of the C-terminal site? Well, the identification really is tentative, but it's based on prior work of another group that has looked at these as a function of pH and really followed these different sites as a function of pH. So they identified the one with the negative D and the small magnitude of D as the N-terminal site, and the rest as the C-terminal site. We've done some theoretical calculations recently, as should actually be 2014, in a paper that came out this year, and where we theoretically calculate the fine structure. So we have the crystal structure, we plug the coordinates in a computer program that does the quantum chemistry and calculates these fine structure parameters for us. And when we do this right, we get the N-terminal site with a negative D and a small magnitude of D. So that clearly shows that it's the more symmetric site. This should be our N-terminal site. The calculations give this as the C-terminal site for the hexacoordinated version, and this as the C-terminal site for the pentacoordinated version. And then we have some additional ones that we don't really know where to stick them to, so we'll just stick them to either the C-terminal site, which is most likely this one, and maybe this is just a different conformation of the N-terminal site. We don't really know. But it's a relatively small amount, and we're really going to focus on the N-terminal site. So the big picture is the N-terminal site has the smallest magnitude of D. And that's a lucky break, because I can look at that at low field as well. I can do pulse DPR in my own lab in Gainesville, where I can now study the ligand environment of that N-terminal site. Okay? Oh, yes, so what I can also do, I can mutate a tryptophan in the second coordination shell of that N-terminal site, and if I do that, I affect the spectrum of just the N-terminal site. You see that here? This is the wild type, this is the mutant. You see that most of that signal that I identified as the N-terminal site starts to go away, and what's left over is a relatively broad spectrum that's representative of the C-terminal sites that I had identified before. Okay, so now that we know the N-terminal site is the one with the smaller D, we can look at that with low field EPR, and I can now go ahead and study how does that oxalate actually bind to my manganese. And the way I'm going to do this is with double resonance. I'm going to use carbon-13 labeled oxalate, where these carbons have a nuclear spin. I put carbon-13 in there that has a nuclear spin of 1/2. And that nuclear spin has to couple to my electron spin on the manganese. And then I can measure the distances between those nuclear spins and my manganese. And if the distances come out right, I can distinguish between monodentate and bidentate binding modes. So before I do this, let me introduce a mutant E280Q. This is a mutant that only has the N-terminal site. Incidentally, that's a mutant that only has small fine structure as well. So that's additional validation for my identification of the N-terminal site as the one with the smaller fine structure. I have a pH dependence of that sextet spectrum, and clearly you see some small changes as the pH is changed. This, by the way, is also in high field at 14.5 Tesla. If I add oxalate to this mutant, the spectrum is locked down. I see exactly the same spectrum no matter what the pH, which tells me oxalate binds even at high pH, not just at low pH where it turns over. And when it binds, what it does, it squeezes the spectrum, it squeezes the sextet. So the orange one is the one without the oxalate, the blue one is the one with the oxalate. That means smaller coupling to the manganese. The electron has a larger wave function to work with when the oxalate is bound, and therefore it has less spin density on the manganese. So that is proof that yes, I'm binding my oxalate to the N-terminal site. And now I can do the double resonance experiment. And here it is, low pH, high pH, same spectrum. This is now a radio frequency axis. Why? Well, because I'm doing an NMR experiment. I'm looking at the NMR of just the carbon-13s that are on the carbon-13 label oxalate that's bound to the manganese. And the intensity here, well, that's the intensity of my EPR spectrum. So the way you do the experiment, you sit on the EPR spectrum, you sit on the EPR absorption, and you scan the radio frequency, and this is then what you get. And you see two beautiful peak patterns. They're called peak patterns, sort of these big maxima, and then they're followed by smaller maxima to the side. And the way we simulate that is with a anisotropic hyperfine coupling to the carbon-13 nucleus, which tells me that I have one distance between my manganese and my carbon-13 of about 3 angstroms. So what that means is that I have bidentate binding modes. I don't observe two distances between the manganese and the carbon-13. I only observe one distance. And that tells me the oxalate really binds bidentate. If I had monodentate binding, I'd expect these sharp lines to be replicated inside the space between these two lines. I'd expect equally sharp lines there. Well, they're absent. Sometimes when I mix my oxalate with a wild-type enzyme, I do see some of those sharp lines popping up, and that simply tells me that I'm freezing out some intermediate that shows a larger distance between my carbon-13 and my manganese. So the absence really is true, and that leads me to believe that I only see one distance between carbon-13 and manganese, which is proof that I have bidentate binding modes. So oxalate appears to bind bidentate to my N-terminal manganese, and it appears to be independent of pH. That, of course, raises important questions about the binding site of oxygen in the enzyme. We know the enzyme has to bind oxygen because oxygen is necessary, but where does it go? Well, this has been explored to some extent by us by trying to substitute nitric oxide for oxygen. Oftentimes, when you have this problem, you can try to put nitric oxide in there. It's a very similar sized molecule. It usually has the same binding site. Now, this is not proof positive. We have to do more work on this. But when we do this, actually, the two next pictures, I'm going to just flip over them. They prove that nitric oxide is actually an inhibitor of the enzyme. And it's an inhibitor that's reversible. It's a reversible inhibitor. So when it's gone, then the enzyme is active again. And so what this spectrum now does is to see where the nitric oxide binds. Does it affect the manganese? And the result is no, it does not. The manganese spectrum is here in the middle. It's not affected by the binding of the nitric oxide. The blue line here is the nitric oxide by itself. And obviously, that orange line here has that nitric oxide spectrum in it. So if I subtract that out, the brown spectrum here is the one where that different spectrum is shown. Looks just like the spectrum without nitric oxide. So my N-terminal manganese does not bind nitric oxide. Again, evidence against oxygen sitting on that N-terminal manganese. It has to sit somewhere else. But where could it be? Where's the oxygen? Well, let's take a look at the enzyme structure again. We have again our trimer from the crystal structure. This would be our N-terminal manganese. The N-terminal to the C-terminal distance is about 26 angstroms. That's a long distance for electron transfer in a protein. If I assume that the enzyme is in a complex, even in solution, I can cut that down to 21 angstrom. Still a long distance for electron transfer. But if I could put my oxygen on the other manganese, that's the way out because I need it somewhere. If it binds to the other oxygen, then I have to invoke long distance electron transfer between them. Well, if I take a closer look at the structure, I find that these two subunits are tied together by a tryptophan dimer, a pi stack dimer. So the tryptophans partially overlap. When you have a situation like this, that's a perfect way station for an electron in a protein to move. So let's take a closer look. This would be the C-terminal manganese on one subunit. This is the N-terminal manganese on the other subunit. See those tryptophans here? They're right smack in the middle. And that cuts down the electron transfer distance to about 7 to 8 angstroms. And that's really a short distance for an electron to hop inside a protein. So my hypothesis is, and that's based on all the evidence that we have so far, that the oxygen binds to the C-terminal side. And the first step is a proton-coupled electron transfer where the electron goes from the N-terminal to the C-terminal side. Okay, I'm almost out of time. Not sure whether we should go to the spin typing or maybe we should wrap it up here.
Yeah, maybe we can leave 5 minutes for questions.
Yeah, so should we? Maybe I should stop here. There's evidence for these two radicals that is in part of my talk, but I'll skip that so we have time for questions. I think I have told you enough about EPR spectroscopy at this point. Don't want anybody to fall asleep. All right, so let me stop here.